nga iyong atanan. That's waray for good morning to all of you. Again, just to reiterate, I promise to discuss contracts as briefly as possible because Professor Lopez Rosario already discussed contracts with you. So instead of 16 hours, I hope to be able to finish contracts today. Okay, maybe in that would be a total of 12 hours maximum, which means tomorrow we will start already with the law on sales. Okay, you have been notified already that I will be handling also or discussing with you the other special contracts aside from sales. Okay, I will just have a little adjustment. After sales, instead of discussing torts and damages, I will immediately go into the other special contracts. Okay, I will discuss instead torts and damages on May 30. That's a Sunday. Okay, so tuloy-tuloy ang discussion sa special contracts. We will have time, definitely enough time for all the special contracts. Okay. Now, to continue with our discussion on consent. Okay. We were about to discuss relative incapacity. Okay. If one of the parties to a contract is relatively incapacitated. I must have failed to discuss with you a scenario in case of an absolute incapacity, specifically minority, where the minor may be bound, okay, to a contract, even if ordinarily he would have a right to institute an action for annulment. That may not happen if the Supreme Court would say the minor actively misrepresented as to his age. Okay, actively misrepresented, well, that is probably a recognition of the fact that civil law, the Civil Code of the Philippines, recognizes misrepresentation in good faith. Okay, but when a minor actively misrepresents as to his age, for example, in a deed of sale, after the name of the party, there would be Filipino and of legal age, or lalo na kung ang nakalagay ay 17 years old, when in fact he's already 9. What is stated there is 19, when he in fact is only 17 years old. That would be an active misrepresentation for which the minor would have no right to institute an action for annulment. In the leading cases, landmark cases in relation to this scenario, the Supreme Court would cite the principle of Stopel as a basis why such minor would not be able to annul such contract. Of course, a few justices would disagree with this basis, because if a person is a minor, how would he know? How can he be expected to know the legal consequences of his acts? Okay? Nonetheless, again, the majority of the justices, and in later cases, in unanimous decisions, a minor who misrepresented as to his age would be bound to a contract. Okay. Now, I mentioned yesterday, last night, that relative incapacity would pertain actually to a prohibition. Okay, the law would prohibit a person from entering into a contract. Okay, but it may pertain only to a specific contract, or only in a specific capacity, like buyer only, or even only with respect to certain persons, like with his spouse, or even with respect to a specific property, like a guardian in relation to the property of his ward. Okay. So who are these persons who are prohibited, okay, from entering into certain contracts? This early, I will have to discuss these contracts so that we will no longer be discussing this aspect under the specific contract. Okay? Let's start with sales. Paborito kasi dito sa sales. Okay? The most number of scenarios where certain persons are prohibited from entering into a contract of sale would be found in Article 1491. Okay? The law provides that the following cannot acquire by purchase. Okay? In other words, they are prohibited from acquiring, meaning only as a buyer. They are not prohibited from selling. Okay? Now, specifically, the law would provide for a guardian. Okay? The guardian cannot acquire by purchase the property of his ward under his guardianship. Or the agent cannot acquire by purchase the property which is under his administration or the property which he is supposed to sell. At least this, in this scenario, this there is a qualification that that may be a valid sale if consented to by the principal. Obviously, that cannot happen in relation to guardians because the ward cannot validly give consent. Kaya may guardianship kasi baliw siya o kasi minor siya. Okay? Now, of course, the executor administrator also is prohibited from acquiring a property which is part of the estate under his administration. Public officers and employees judges, etc., as to properties which are under litigation. Now, I'll start with the status of these contracts because this is debated. Okay, some authors, unbelievably, including Tolentino. Okay, I would admit Tolentino is one of my idols. Okay, sa civil law. However, equally, siguro si Justice JBL Reyes. Wala lang masyadong libro si Justice JBL Reyes, pero magaling talaga si Justice JBL Reyes. But in this issue, Professor Tolentino would take the position, ito pala. If you noticed, Professor Tolentino has 5 volumes, di ba? Volumes 1, 2, 3, 4. And the 5th volume would pertain to special contracts, including torts and damages. You can just imagine all the special contracts and torts and damages contained only in one volume. Okay? That is why I've been very vocal about this, that probably the worst work of Professor Tolentino is Volume 5. Okay? If you have to read the books of Professor Tolentino, by all means, volumes 1 to 4. Ang one of the best would be Succession and isa pa, Oblicon. Okay? But volume 5 is the worst. Okay? Even De Leon, for example, would already have at least 3 books on special contracts. Isa sa sales, isa sa credit transaction, isa sa agency partnership and trust. Di ba? Of course, torts and damages would also be the coverage of textbooks, okay, by itself, torts and damages. So, medyo pagod na siguro siya nung volume 5, okay? Now, thus, in this issue, he would take the position that all these contracts are merely voidable under 1491, okay? Now, together with Professor Paras, etc. But other authors like Justice Vitug, Professor Baviera, etc., would consider all these contracts under 1491 as void contracts. Okay? But there are a few authors, at least Professor De Leon Pineda, who would consider the first 3 scenarios as void, the voidable merely, the last 3 would be void, okay? So medyo, ano sila, nag-compromise. First 3 voidable, the last 3 void. I am definitely convinced that all these contracts are void, okay? First, let's consider at least the reasons given by Professor De Leon why the first 3 would only be considered as voidable. Okay, First, allegedly because these contracts, under the first three paragraphs, yung sa guardian, agent, executor, executor administrator, would only affect private interest. Okay? But does it matter whether only private interests are affected or not? Does it matter whether it is only the interest of the agent and the principal as to whether a contract or a stipulation would be void or valid? It doesn't matter. Professor De Leon himself would explain the rationale for this prohibition. Okay? He devoted at least two pages as to the rationale, which is that these people are prohibited from acquiring because of public policy. Now, if a contract or a stipulation is contrary to public policy, would that contract merely be a voidable contract? I don't think so. Okay? Any act, any contract, any stipulation which is contrary to public policy is clearly a void contract or a void stipulation. Second, he would consider these contracts only voidable, allegedly because these contracts can be ratified. Okay? So if a contract can be ratified, then it is not void. Void contracts cannot be the subject of ratification, okay? He would say. Now, the misconception must have been based on the ruling of the Supreme Court in the case of Rubias versus Batilier, okay? In that case, in relation to these paragraphs, first three paragraphs of 1491, the Supreme Court said that these contracts can be ratified, pero ratified na quote-unquote, okay? Kinote-unquote ng Supreme Court ang word na ratified. Why? Okay, if the guardian bought the property of his ward, during the guardianship pa, he is prohibited under 1491. But what if the ward, for example, attained the age of majority, okay? So hindi na siya ward, okay? Now, what if he sold the same property to the guardian again? This time, siya na talaga ang nagbenta. Would that sale now be a valid sale? The answer is yes, because wala na ang kanyang incapacity. At the time of the execution of the second contract, there is no more incapacity, and therefore the contract may be a valid and binding contract. And in a way, therefore, the second contract ratified the first. But the Supreme Court would say only ratified, quote-unquote. Why? Because would the effect of the second contract retroact to the date of the execution of the first contract? The answer is no. Said the Supreme Court, the effect of the second contract will only start from the moment that contract was executed. In other words, the second contract did not really ratify the first contract, because in the real sense of ratification, that would have cleansed the contract, the first contract, of all its defects from the very start, as if the contract had no defect. But that is not the case. Since the effect of the second contract will not retroact, effectively the first contract is not voidable. It is really void because the effect cannot retroact. Otherwise, kung voidable lang yan, there should be no problem with ratification. Okay? Probably the last reason of Professor De Leon why this contract is treated merely as voidable is the ruling of the Supreme Court in the case of Wolfson versus Martinez. Okay, again, this is really wrong, because even in Rubias again versus Batilla, the Supreme Court had ruled that the ruling in Wolfson versus Martinez to the effect that these contracts are merely voidable had long been abandoned by the Supreme Court even before the effectivity of the Civil Code of the Philippines. Okay? Ultimately, why would these contracts really be void and not merely voidable? Because these persons are prohibited. Okay? And under 1409, one of the contracts under paragraph 7, of 1409, prohibited contracts are void contracts. Okay, in fact, 1491 is just the next article of 1490. in 1490, spouses are also prohibited from selling to each other. Okay? So a husband cannot sell to his wife as a rule because there are exceptions. Okay? Unless they agreed for a separation of property regime in their marriage settlement. Or even without such marriage settlement, if they obtained a separation of property, a judicial separation of property decree. Okay? But as to the spouses of 1490, is there an issue as to the status of the contract? Wala. The contract entered into by the spouses is void and not merely voidable. So kung 1490, the spouses are prohibited, void, in the same manner, 1491, this contract should also be considered void. Okay? Now, okay, spouses. As to the executors, okay? A case here was decided by the Supreme Court in relation to a sale or assignment of the rights of an heir after the death of the person whose property is under consideration, which happened, a sale to the executor of his rights, okay, before the partition of the estate. Would that be covered by 1491? Of course, that is not covered, okay? A sale covered by 1491 should involve a property which is a part of the estate under the administration of the executor, okay? And what was assigned by the heir to the executor, his rights in relation to the estate, is not a property which is part of the estate. It is his own property. And that right is vested upon him upon the death of such person. Okay? Now, of course, always be conscious that lawyers, for example, or judges, the members of the staff of the court, are only prohibited from acquiring a property under litigation. Okay? So once the case had already been terminated, disposed of, tapos na, nanalo na ang kliyente ng abogado, then the client can now sell the property to his lawyer. Okay? It is only when the sale happened during the pendency of the case over such property that the law would prohibit such sale. Okay? Now, then, of course, aliens, okay, which is a favorite. If a contract of sale involving a private land is entered into by an alien, does that mean that the sale is void? The answer is no. Again, under the Constitution, he is only prohibited from acquiring, transfer to, or conveyance to, not from, okay? And therefore, if he is the seller, there should be no problem, okay? Now, if he is the buyer, okay, of this private land, is it actually possible for the sale to be valid? The answer is yes, okay? Because there's another exception under the Constitution, which is if he is a former natural-born Filipino citizen, okay? And of course, the law on the matter would only allow such foreigner, alien na siya, he was a former natural-born Filipino citizen, to acquire parcels of land for residential purposes, okay? Again, it should be clear that not every former Filipino citizen, but only former natural-born Filipino citizen, okay? This is, in a way, similar to the issue of which affected Fernando Po Jr., the late Fernando Po. There was a question as to whether he is a Filipino or a natural-born Filipino citizen, okay? Of course, I will be discussing a specific sale in relation where one of the contracting parties was an alien when we discuss the law on sales, which was asked last year, okay? A question sa bar exam last year pertains to an alien, okay? Now, another person who is prohibited from buying also, okay, is the unpaid seller, okay? If you remember under the law on sales, unpaid sellers, an unpaid seller in the exercise of the right of resale cannot directly or indirectly purchase the thing. Okay? Now, so we can proceed to the scenario where consent was given by persons who have the capacity to give consent. Does that mean that the contract is valid and binding? Again, not necessarily. Okay? Because even if the person giving consent has the capacity to give consent, the consent may have been vitiated. Okay? Or the person gave consent, but it was in representation of another. Okay? And the person giving consent has the capacity to give consent, but he was not given authority by the person he is representing. Obviously, that contract would be unenforceable. Okay? Unenforceable unless he has the authority of the law or he has the authority of the court. Okay? He may not have the authority of the person he is representing, but if he has the authority of the law, then the sale or the contract may be a valid contract. Example, of course, would pertain to guardians. Okay? The guardian may not have the authority of the ward, but he has the authority of the law to enter into certain contracts on behalf of the ward. Okay? Now, in fact, a sheriff would sell a property of a person even against the will of that person. Okay? Obviously, he doesn't have the authority of that person, but the sale may be a valid sale. Now, into vitiation of consent. The law enumerates five causes that vitiate consent. These are also known as vices of consent. Okay? Mistake or error, violence, intimidation, undue influence, or fraud. Okay? And fraud. I'll start with the nature of these causes. What is the effect of each of these causes? Okay? What is the effect of mistake? The effect of a mistake is similar to the effect of fraud. Okay? It prevents a person from having knowledge of certain facts. Okay? This affects awareness. This affects knowledge. Thus, it goes into cognition. Okay? On the other hand, violence, intimidation, undue influence, all would affect the voluntariness of the act. Okay? They are compelled to give consent because there was violence, because there was intimidation, because there was undue influence. Okay? Considering the effects of these causes, okay, I'll go directly to the effect of violence or intimidation or undue influence employed by a third person upon one of the parties, even without the connivance of the other party. Okay? If violence is employed by a third person upon one of the parties, even without the knowledge of the other party, under the law, that would give the right to institute an action for annulment. Okay? The person upon whom violence was employed, even if not employed by the other contracting party, would have the right to institute an action for annulment. In the same manner that if intimidation was employed, that there would be the same result. That would have the same result. The contract would likewise be voidable. The person upon whom intimidation was employed would have the right to institute an action for annulment. The problem here is, what if undue influence was employed by a third person? The law would not expressly so provide for the effect of such undue influence. Would that also result in a voidable contract? Well, an argument would be that the law did not provide for such. The law only would provide for violence, intimidation. Therefore, that should not result in a voidable contract. But that argument is wrong. Going into the effects of this these vices, okay? Considering that violence and intimidation would affect the voluntariness of the act. However, undue influence also would have the same effect. Does it matter if such was employed by the other contracting party or by a third person? The better answer is it should not matter. So even the Code Commission itself would take the position that even if it was not expressly provided, that violence employed by a third person would result in a voidable contract, it would have the same effect as violence and intimidation. Okay? Now, into these vices, let's start with mistake. Okay? Mistake should pertain to a fact. Okay? As a rule, mistake as to law will not result in a voidable contract, basically because of, is it Article 6, which provides that ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith. Kung sabi ng isa, ay, akala ko ganito, that will not be a valid defense because, again, ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith. By way of exception, however, the law under 1334 provides that if there is mutual error as to the legal effect of an agreement and the purpose of the parties is frustrated, that may vitiate consent and therefore the contract would be voidable. Take note, the law requires mutual error, okay, as to the legal effect of an agreement. Now, but again, as a rule, the mistake must pertain to a fact, mistake of fact. But every mistake of fact would be a ground for the annulment of the contract? Of course not. Okay? For example, if this is a sale of a car and the buyer filed an action for the annulment of the contract on the ground that there was mistake as to the stereo in the car. Okay? Ang akala niya ay Pioneer. Yung pala, Alps pala. Tama ba? Alps ba ang pronunciation? There is such a brand na Alps, okay? Now, that mistake as to the stereo would definitely, I would say, not be a ground for the annulment of the contract because the law would require that for mistake of fact to be a ground for the annulment of a contract, the mistake must pertain first, either to the substance of the thing or to a condition or conditions which principally move that party to enter into that contract. So let's consider the stereo in relation to the car. Is the stereo the substance of the car? I don't think so, okay? Because you don't buy a car because of the stereo, okay? Maybe somebody should tell me that I bought this car because of the stereo, okay? Hindi naman siguro. If you want, you can just change the stereo, di ba? Yung iba, pinapalitan nila lahat-lahat in relation to the stereo. But if there is a mistake as to the engine of the car, okay, ang akala niya, I don't know, if is there a 3.0? Mayroon yata, no? Yung mga race car, okay? Ang akala niya 3.0, yung pala 1.3 lang, ay goes into the substance of the thing, okay? If he really wanted to use the thing as a race car, 1.3 ay alikabok lang ang makukuha niya, di ba? Kung ang engine is only 1.3. Okay? Now, but the mistake may not pertain to the substance, but if it pertains to a condition which principally moved a party to enter the contract, that contract would likewise be voidable. Example, if a person entered into a contract of sale involving a parcel of land, a house and lot, and there was mistake as to the classification of the area, he thought there was mistake as to the classification, ang akala niya commercial area, when in fact, the zoning ordinance, it was still a residential area. Okay? I think this can be considered as a mistake which principally moved one of the parties to enter a contract and therefore the contract may be annulled. Okay? Now, into the mistake as to the identity of a person or mistake as to the qualification. Like if a party would file an action for annulment on the ground that he thought the buyer was a lawyer, eh, hindi pala lawyer, would that be a valid ground for the annulment? As a rule, that is not a valid ground. Who cares if the buyer is a lawyer or not, or a doctor or not, okay? As long as he has the purchasing power, di ba? Maski taong grasa siya, basta may pera siya, okay na yan under the law on sales, okay? Now, of course, if that qualification or identity was the principal cause of the contract, but when would the qualification or identity be the principal cause, okay? A good example would pertain to a contract of guarantee, where the qualification of the guarantor would be very much relevant as to whether or not the creditor would enter into such contract, di ba? Kung akala niya ay napakayaman, asyendero, may asyenda. Tama, no? Asyenda. Yung pala, asyendero lang. Then, apparently, there's a mistake as to the identity or qualification of one of the parties. But take note, I think may mga asyendero na mga mayayaman. Di ba? Yung talagang ikta-iktarya ang kanilang asinan. Okay? Kaya depende rin. Parang pag sinabi natin sa Pilipinas, farmer, pag sinabing farmer sa Pilipinas, mahirap, di ba? Parang ordinarily. Pero sa US, pag sinabi kang farmer, mayaman ka, di ba? Yung mga farmers sa US. So depende talaga. Now, again, simple mistake of account obviously would not be a ground for the annulment of a contract. It would only give rise to its correction, okay? Into violence, okay? What if in the problem, what was mentioned was duress, okay? Is this one of the vices of consent, duress? Mukhang wala naman sa batas, di ba? Not expressly recognized under the law. But actually, duress would cover both violence and intimidation, okay? So if the problem says there was duress, either violence was employed or there was intimidation, okay? Let's start with general duress or collective duress. Would this be a ground for the annulment of the contract? The answer is no. Ang collective duress or general duress would pertain to intimidation or violence employed in general, in a particular locality, okay? For example, this would be a common defense or a ground for annulment of contracts entered into during the Japanese occupation, okay? They would claim that because violence was employed upon our neighbors, we were compelled to sell also our properties, okay? That is not a valid ground, okay? General duress or collective duress per se is not a ground. Duress or violence or intimidation must be employed upon specific persons. Okay? The question is upon whom? Okay? Upon whom should violence be employed in order for the contract to be voidable? What if violence was employed upon the child of one of the parties? If you will read the provision, apparently, that would not result in a voidable contract. That would not give rise to a right to institute an action for annulment because the law only says there is violence when in order to wrest consent, serious or irresistible force is employed. The law did not provide that even if employed upon a person, not one of the contracting parties, the contract would be voidable, unlike in intimidation. In intimidation, the law is very clear that if this is employed not only upon the person of the party to the contract, but also upon his spouse, descendants, or ascendants, the contract would be voidable. So if the intimidation was employed upon the son, a descendant, then the contract would be voidable. But in violence, there was no mention. So it may be claimed that violence must be employed only upon one of the contracting parties in order for the contract to be voidable. But I also would agree that this is not a good conclusion. Okay? because of the nature of violence and the nature of intimidation. In intimidation, there is no actual force exerted yet. Threats pa lang, di ba? Threat pa lang, even if employed upon the child, the party would already have a right of action. Eh, lalo na if there was already violence or there was already serious force employed upon his child. Because of the gravity of violence, even if the law did not so provide expressly, violence employed upon the spouse, ascendants, or descendants should also have the same effect as intimidation. Okay? The problem actually here is, what if violence or intimidation was employed upon a person who is not one of those mentioned under the law? Hindi doon sa party, not to his spouse, not to his descendants, one of his descendants or ascendants. May the contract still be voidable? I would agree that it may still be voidable, okay? Even if employed upon a person who is not one of those mentioned under the law. As long as he can prove that there was really vexation of consent, he was really compelled because of the serious force, because of intimidation, to enter into that contract. There was physical compulsion or moral compulsion to enter into the contract. However, I would agree with one of the authors who stated in his book that the further the relationship between the party to the contract and the person upon whom violence or intimidation was employed, the greater would be the difficulty of proving that there was vexation of consent, di ba? Kasi kung ang tao upon whom violence was employed was your third cousin, parang hindi mo na nga minsan siya kilala eh, di ba? So hindi kayo masyadong close, okay? But possibly then, a good example of a person upon whom violence may be employed, even if such person is not one of those mentioned under the civil code, would be a fiancé, di ba? Eh, kakasal na kayo, halimbawa, kakasal na kayo in 3 days, okay? And violence was employed upon that person. Of course, there may have been vexation of consent why a person may enter into that contract. Although a fiancé is neither, hindi pa naman siya spouse, hindi siya descendant, hindi siya ascendant. Okay? Now, what else? Okay? Violence, intimidation. Of course, in relation to intimidation, you always have to consider the age, the sex, etc. In relation to the persons, okay? Kasi naman, if the person claiming intimidation was already 35 years old and the person who allegedly intimidated him was only 14 years old, parang hindi ka panipaniwala, di ba? A better scenario here would there... Of course, again, I mentioned already the age and, of course, the sex and the condition of the person, okay? Even the physical condition of the person. In relation to the undue influence, okay? In order that there would be undue influence, there must have been a relationship between the parties, okay? Wherein one would have the power over the other, okay? Example, of course, would be a priest and his parishioner, or I would accept even a teacher and his student. Okay, as such, of course, it would be the student who would have undue influence over the teacher. Okay, now again, the one who has the power over the other, okay, would may have undue influence over the other party. Okay. As to fraud, you must have discussed fraud under 1171, but that is not fraud in relation to consent, okay? Fraud in 1171 is fraud in the performance of an obligation, okay? The premise of those articles is that there is already an obligation and there was fraud in the fulfillment, okay? Here, the fraud here in contracts is fraud in obtaining consent, okay? This is the only kind of fraud because this fraud can only occur in contracts because it is only in contracts that consent is required. Okay? Now, you must have discussed the effects of fraud under 1170. I'm not sure if she distinguished that from fraud under 1338 and 1344. But fraud under 1170 would result in damages, can be the basis of an action for damages. Whereas under 1338, this is known as causal fraud or dolo causante. Okay? Without such fraud, a party would not have entered into that contract. Okay, a good example here would be that the other party misrepresented as to the thing which was sold. For example, sabi niya, this is a 24 karat gold na ring, when in fact, gold-plated lang. That is definitely causal fraud. That is dolo causante. Without such fraud, that a buyer would not have entered into that contract. But there is another kind of fraud in contracts, which is incidental fraud under 1344. This would not result in a voidable contract, but would rather entitle the aggrieved parties to damages. Okay? In this kind of fraud, even without this fraud, the party, one of the parties, would still have entered into that contract, but probably under different terms and conditions. Okay? Halimbawa, pwedeng 24 karat, pero hindi naman talaga 24, baka 22 lang or 20. He may have bought the ring nonetheless, but he may have bought it at a price less than that agreed upon. This is merely incidental fraud, okay? And then under 1344, an action for annulment, therefore, would not be the appropriate action. It should have been an action for damages, okay? Finally, if consent was reluctantly given, would that affect the validity of the contract? Okay, a good case here is the case of Lagunsad versus Gonzales, involving a movie. Ang title ng movie, The Moises Padilla Story, I think. Okay, those who are from Negros would know that there is a town now in the 5th district of Negros na ang pangalan ay Moises Padilla. Okay. Although to this day, masikat pa rin siya by its original name. In this case, an action was filed against the producer of the movie by the heirs of Moises Padilla. Okay? Now, and in a way, he entered into a contract with his heirs in relation to the royalties, etc. But later on, he would not want to recognize this contract on the ground that there was vitiation of his consent because he reluctantly gave consent. Otherwise, the showing of the movie would have been suspended, okay, because of the action. But the Supreme Court obviously ruled that just because he reluctantly gave consent does not affect the validity of the contract. The contract still would be a valid and binding contract. Okay? Not a favorite again, but in relation to the offer and the acceptance. Okay? Under the law, consent is manifested by the meeting of the offer and the acceptance. Okay? So, mayroong offer, may acceptance. The moment nag-meet itong dalawang ito in relation to the object and the consideration, then there is consent. Okay? But the law requires the offer to be certain. Okay? You must have all noticed yung mga billboards, di ba? In some billboards, some things may be offered, like parcels of land may be offered. But the law provides that unless it appears otherwise, business advertisements of things for sale are not definite offers. But there are certain instances wherein you would consider an offer to be definite. Kasi the specific location of the property may have been stated in the advertisement, okay? Even the TCT number, the area of the lot, etc., would be stated in the billboard. So if there was acceptance of such offer, there could have been a perfected contract, okay? Now, of course, before the acceptance of the offer, if the offerer died or the offerer became insolvent or he suffered civil interdiction or he became insane, then the offer is deemed terminated. Okay? Wala na. Even if thereafter there was acceptance, there would be no perfected contract. Okay? Now, we have discussed somehow in one of the first bar exam questions that if the offer is not accepted, okay, if there is a qualified acceptance, example, instead of 60,000, sabi niya, o sige, bibilin ko, pero 50,000 na lang. That's a qualified acceptance. There is no perfected contract here. Instead, there is a counter offer. And the counter offer, in a counter offer, the offeree became now the offerer. And the offerer now would have the decision whether to accept or reject the counter offer. Okay? Then, as the law requires, the acceptance must be absolute. Okay? If the offer was made through an agent, would it suffice that the acceptance was also made or conveyed to the agent? The answer is yes. Okay? The acceptance need not have been known to the principal, because a scenario here could have been after the offer was made by an agent in representation of the principal, and the offeree conveyed his acceptance to the agent, and before the agent could inform the principal died. Is there a perfected contract? Would the estate of the deceased principal still be bound to this contract? The answer is yes. Okay? The moment the acceptance is conveyed to the agent, that already binds the principal. Even if the principal had no knowledge still of this contract, that is already a valid and binding contract. Okay? Now, going into the object of contracts. I mentioned last night that contracts may pertain either to things, rights, or services. Okay? Or service. Now, the question now then is, what are the requirements in order for a thing or for service or for a right to be the subject matter of a valid contract? The easiest to answer would pertain to a right, okay? Because the only requirement for a right to be the subject matter of valid contract is that the right must not be intransmissible. Yun lang. We have already discussed the scenarios when a right would be intransmissible, because the law so provides, because there's a stipulation, or because of the nature of the right. Okay? If you will be a counsel of a corporation, ordinarily when a corporation enters into a contract, okay, medyo normally, yung ibang contract would be a little bit complicated, there would normally be a clause in that contract, commonly called non-assignability clause. Okay? Thus, by stipulation of the parties, the rights arising from that contract cannot be assigned, at least without the consent of the other party. Okay? Now, that would be as to rights. Okay? Rights, again, would include credits, ang pinaka-common probably. I'm sure you've been a creditor sometime in your life. Hindi naman palaging tayo ang nangungutang, di ba? Sometimes tayo ang inuutangan, okay? As a creditor, you have a right, that's a credit, which you can actually assign or you can sell, okay? Now, of course, shares of stocks are rights, actually. Now, as to services, medyo madali lang din. The law only requires that the First, of course, the service should not be impossible, okay? But aside from that, the service should not be contrary to law, morals, etc. As to rights, you should have noticed the law did not require that the rights should not be contrary to law, morals, etc. Di ba? In fact, as to things, the law requires the thing must be licit. But why not as to rights? Is it not required that a right must not be contrary to law? Mukhang hindi na. Kasi right nga siya eh. It's in the nature of the concept. It is a right. It should not be contrary to law. Kasi kung contrary to law, hindi siya right. Wrong siya, di ba? Kaya mukhang the law would not require such. But take note, even yung rights would change. A right before may no longer be a right today. Okay? Panapanahon lang yan. Okay? But ang medyo komplikado would pertain to things. There are a few requirements for a thing to be the subject matter of a valid contract. Okay? Example, a sale of the air in this room, itong mga nandito, okay? Di man natin nakikita masyado, but you can feel the air, lalo na kung medyo may electric fan, okay? Would that be a valid sale of the air? The answer is no, because such is outside the commerce of men, okay? Cannot be the subject of commercial transaction. Anything which is of common ownership, okay, is considered to be outside the commerce of men. But take note, just like water sa rivers, water sa dagat, okay? Yung water flowing out of a well is outside the commerce. But the moment there is an appropriation of such thing, okay, it now becomes the subject of a commercial transaction, okay? A good example here as to air, dito sa air, out of this air, ang component niyan is oxygen. Di ba? Kasama sa air, ang isa dyan, oxygen. Kung ma-appropriate mo ang oxygen, now you can sell the oxygen. Obviously, in hospitals, kailangan ang oxygen. But you must have seen this feature of a restaurant in Makati selling oxygen, okay, to its customers, okay? Habang yung iba ay nagyoyosi, ikaw naka-oxygen, o di ba? Medyo clean living ang dating mo. Because mas malala ang second-hand smoking, di ba? Tama, no? Second-hand smoking or passive smoking. Actually, my doctor would always tell me na yun siguro ang culprit, okay? I may not be smoking, but I frequent places na maraming nag-smoke, okay? So if I drink, siguro sa mga na umiinom dito, I'd say 90% nag-smoke habang umiinom. But I love to drink, but I don't love smoking. Since I love to drink with people who are smoking, parang nag-smoke na rin ako. E mas malala. Kaya itong restaurant na ito, nagbibenta ng oxygen, okay? Diba? So habang nakipag-inuman ka sa iba, naka-oxygen ka, okay? At least mababawasan ang ano mo sakit sa alcohol na lang, okay? But there is one other advertisement feature about yung isang device na highly oxygenated would be very very useful to some people suffering certain diseases. Sa tingin ko pwede ako doon. The person would just enter a certain parang cube lang siya na talagang highly oxygenated. Kaya lang, mga tipong ano lang, for 1 hour inside, you just have to pay mga 10,000 pesos. Ganun lang siya kamura, okay? Dito na lang ako sa oxygen na ito for 10,000, okay? Now, of course, water, obviously, pag na-appropriate ng water, mas mahal pa kaysa oil, okay? 1 liter of oil, compare mo sa 1 liter of water. Ah, there would be a time na mas mahal ang tubig. Pero ngayon, mas mahal talaga ang... Pero pag mga maliliit lang na ganito, I think mas mahal ito kaysa oil, di ba? 20 years ago, no one in his right mind would have imagined water would be sold at this price, okay? Now, again, things outside the commerce of men, and that would include roads. Are roads outside the commerce of men? Not all the roads, okay? There are private roads, okay? In fact, Forbes Park would maintain yung kanilang roads as private roads. Kaya nga naging issue ang whether they can be compelled to allow private cars from passing through yung kanilang village, okay? Because private ang road na yan, okay? Yung ilang subdivisions, nagiging public lang ang roads because the owner or the members of the subdivision would actually donate the roads to the city government. Of course, hindi dahil mabait sila normally, kundi dahil they want these public officials to be responsible for the maintenance of the roads. Mahal mag-maintain ng road. Plus, they don't have to pay real property tax in relation to these roads, okay? Pero EDSA obviously is outside the commerce of men, okay? Now, internal organs, okay? A transaction or a sale is specifically involving internal organs, may that be a valid transaction or sale. When I say transaction, that would involve donations, okay? But a commercial transaction like a sale, it may be valid. Basta hindi lang sa tao, di ba? Basta sa mga kalabaw lang at saka sa mga kabayo, okay? Internal organs. But as to human internal organs, obviously, the sale cannot be considered as a valid sale. That would be outside the commerce of men, okay? So far, okay? There are those advocating the legalization of sale, for example, of kidneys, okay? Diba? But I think also mukhang hindi maganda ang ano na yan. I can understand people suffering from yung problem sa kidney. They would they may want, diba? Kasi others would die na walang makuhang donor, okay? But some people are a bit fortunate, okay? Unbelievably, I had three friends, okay, who had transplants last year in just 1 year, okay? Yung isa was really fortunate, okay? He was diagnosed as yung grabe na, may renal ano, shutdown na in less than 3 months, okay? Somebody suffered a vehicular accident, okay? Yun nga, ang ano sa kidney pala, kailangan nagmamatch, di ba? Ang donor at saka donee, may tipong 4 areas, okay? Pag nagmatch ka sa 3, ay most often than not, okay yan. Lalo na kung sa 4, which is rare. So pagdating sa order, yung pinakamaraming match, siya ang number 1. Yung friend ko had only parang 2 or 1 na nagmatch. So, second lang siya. Akala niya he will no longer be the beneficiary of a transplant. But it turned out he was asked to prepare 3 o'clock. By 11 o'clock in the evening, he was called for an operation. It turned out the person died. Since a person has 2 kidneys, edi 2 ang nag-benefit. Yung first at saka siya, pangalawa. Okay? Yun lang, it's not that easy to have a transplant. Okay? Una, yung cost, you should have at least mga 300,000. Kung hindi, walang operasyon. Okay? And after the operation, in a week, at least mga 40,000 a month ang maintenance. And that could be forever. But again, things outside the commerce of men. Ano pa yung mga outside the commerce of men as ruled by the Supreme Court? Portions of navigable rivers, okay? Martinez versus Court of Appeals. Even if this portion of a navigable river was sold 8 times, did the 8th buyer acquired ownership? The Supreme Court said no, never, okay? Because this is outside the commerce of men. The contracts are void. Now, sacred things, including churches. Okay, church here would be the physical church, not of course the Roman Catholic Church, but the physical structure. Okay, would be outside the commerce of men, as ruled by the Supreme Court. I think this is a good ruling, because ordinarily, especially the old churches, these were built because of blood the effort of our countrymen, di ba? Kaya naitayo ang mga simbahan, and therefore not even the Pope should have the right to sell the church. Okay? But that would include yung mga sacred items. So if you have heard months ago, there were robberies involving sacred items, yung ninanakaw yung mga nasa simbahan, like I think kasama yung mga chalice, mga ganyan. Sale involving those items would be considered as void sales as they are outside the commerce of men. Siguro probably ang gagawin nila ay kung gold ito, tutunawin nila ang gold, di ba? So hindi nila malalaman na sacred item pala yon. Okay? Now, what else? Okay, things outside the commerce of men. Of course, there are things, there are animals, for example, which are considered as endangered, okay? And therefore, even possession of these things, mere possession, are considered unlawful, okay? Now, but the law, as I mentioned, requires the thing to be licit, okay? Not be contrary to law, morals, etc. Things contrary to law, of course, would include shabu, even marijuana. Okay, of course, there are people who are also advocating the legalization of marijuana. Okay, yung mga addict. Okay, pero hindi naman, joke lang yon. Okay, there are people na hindi addict who are advocating legalization, and I am actually open to that. Okay. Because I have read several articles, yung iba thesis, okay, as to the legalization of marijuana. If only for the fact that all over the world, there are only a few countries, including the Philippines, who would actually consider this as an illicit substance, di ba? Not even the United States, as in all the states. I'd say most states in the United States, hindi prohibited substance, kundi regulated substance lang ang marijuana. In recent, meron silang mga proposition, di ba, subject to plebiscite nila, normally nananalo ang legalization of marijuana. Just a few months ago sa US, again, there were laws in some states passed na allowing the use of marijuana, for example, for certain patients. Kasi yung medical use ng marijuana had been proven already, medically proven. So sa mga nagsasuffer ng tipong cancer, mga ganyang sakit, among other diseases, marijuana may be used. Okay? Parang in a way, okay na rin yun. They are suffering so much pain, at least pwede na silang mag-marijuana, di ba? Hindi na masyadong masama, okay? But here in the Philippines, obviously, marijuana is still a prohibited substance. The other reason, of course, is yung economic aspect, okay? A few countries would actually have marijuana as the main earner, di ba? Income earner ng countries, marijuana, okay? O di, i-produce lang natin, tapos export natin sa iba. Sila na lang ang suminghot, tayo ang mag-produce. Okay? But ang main argument dito, tingin ko din, is there is no inherent illegality in the substance. Okay? And just like other things, it can be the subject of abuse. Just because na abuso doesn't mean na masama, di ba? Just like itak, di ba? Yung mga bolo, pwedeng pumatay kung gamitin mo pampatay. But you can use it also for agricultural purposes, di ba? So it depends really on the use. Kaya there are certain substances which are merely regulated, okay? Regulated, which means you can only bring, for example, a few grams. Hindi naman kilo-kilo ang dala mo, okay? Pusher ka na nun pag kilo-kilo ang dala mong marijuana, okay? Now, then, what else, okay? Things which are contrary. Contrary to morals, again, nako, marami. Before, even in the 40s up to the 50s, okay, ang mga contraceptives like pills were considered contrary to morals, okay? Kaya, if you know the history of pills, if tama ang nabasa ko, the pills were not introduced as contraceptives in the United States. The pills were introduced as food supplements, di ba? May pagkatawag lang food supplement, pero ang effect, contraceptive. Okay? Pero obviously, revolutionary ang pills, at least it started in the United States, because with the pills, dumami na sa working class ang mga babae. Okay? Before, halos walang mga babae sa labor force. But with the pills, abad, dumami na sila. Okay? That is really revolutionary. In fact, in certain cases, example, when a member of the medical staff ng isang school was found distributing mga ganitong pills, condoms, that was a ground for termination because that was considered before as contrary to morals. But apparently today, Philippine law does not consider such as illicit, okay? Because pills, condoms would be sold almost anywhere, okay? Maski sa mercury drug, di ba? Thus, although some sectors would still consider these things to be contrary to morals, but not Philippine law, okay? Then, what else? Tingnan nyo yung issue ng reproductive health. It was not really the decisive issue sa election, okay? Whether pro-reproductive health ka or hindi, the people really doesn't mind, okay? I am definitely in agreement with the claim that ang tao sa election na ito, ang pinaka number one na issue ay corruption, okay? Yun talaga ang pinaka-issue. So whoever would have the trust of the people in relation to that issue, siya ang iboboto. Okay? At maniwala kayo, others would actually say, anako, yung mga masa, hindi marunong bumoto. Minsan marunong. Okay? Pag nafe-feel na nila sa kanilang mga tiyan, alam na nila. Okay? Dahil pag ang corruption tumama sa tiyan, they will be very much affected. Pag na-realize nila, ganito ang effect pala sa economic status nila, they would understand. And I think it was properly, they were properly informed of this issue in this election. Okay? Now, things, okay? Okay na tayo dyan, okay? Sa subject matter or object. Again, do not confuse object or subject matter from things. The object of a contract need not be a thing. Okay? The object of a contract may be the rendition of service. Okay? Object is the subject matter, which may pertain to a thing. Okay? Finally, as to the cause. Okay? If in a board exam question, a person bought a gun in order for him to have a gun to kill somebody else. And he in fact killed that other person. Would that affect the validity of the sale? Would the sale be a void sale? The answer is no. Because the law expressly provides that the cause of a contract is different from the motive. Okay? The cause in a contract is the essential reason which impels a party to enter into that contract. And we have discussed the causes already. Okay? Example, in onerous contracts, the cost as to each contracting party is the promise or prestation to be delivered or to be performed by the other party. Okay? So a person would buy a gun because the cost is because the other party promised to deliver and transfer ownership. As to the cost, the parties are aware as to the causes or the cost as to each party. But ordinarily, the parties would not know the motive of the other party or they would not even care. Okay? Example, in the sale of that gun, the seller would not ask the buyer, saan mo gagamitin ang baril? Okay? Baka pag ganun pa ang gawin niya, eh baka hindi na siya bilhan, hindi na bumili sa kanya. Parang pakialam mo kung saan ko gagamitin, di ba? So, the parties would not normally know the motive, but they should know the cause. Now, since the motive is different from the cause, would the illegality of the motive affect the validity of the contract? As a rule, it does not. Okay? The illegality of the motive does not affect the validity of the contract, except there are exceptions to this rule. Okay? When the motive may be regarded as the cause if the motive predominates the purpose of the contract. Okay? Why the party entered into the contract was because of the motive. A good example here is when the motive of the seller was to defraud his creditor. Obviously, this is contrary to law, and therefore the law provides that when the transaction is in fraud of a creditor, it may be considered as a rescissible contract, or it is a rescissible contract. Okay? Now, also for example, if the motive of the sale or the transactions was to circumvent a provision of the law, of course, that would also result in a void contract. A good example here would pertain to 1490, which prohibits spouses from selling to each other. So, for example, what if the wife would sell to a third person, and then a few days, the third person would sell the same property to the husband? Well, from the facts, it appears that the transactions, the two contracts of sale, were entered into only to circumvent 1490 because they cannot sell to each other. Ang ginawa, aba, idinaan pa sa third person. But that would result in a void contract, as the Supreme Court would say. What else? Okay. As to the cause, since we have already discussed the causes in depending on the kind of contract, onerous, gratuitous, and remuneratory, a question here na lang is, what is the cause in an accessory contract? Like a pledge, what is the cause in a mortgage? Okay? The answer, is it the same cause in the principal contract? Not necessarily. It depends on who entered into that accessory contract. Because accessory contracts like pledge and mortgage may be executed by third persons. Okay? If the person who entered into the contract as pledge or mortgagor is the principal debtor himself, there is no problem. The cause in the principal contract will be the same reason why he pledged his property. However, if he is a third person, well, the cause may be liberality. Kaya siya nag-pledge ng kanyang property kasi brother niya ang principal debtor, kasi anak niya ang principal debtor. So, liberality may be the cause. Or some people would actually require compensation in order for him to mortgage his property. And that would definitely be an onerous contract. Okay? Now, as to this requisite, what if in a deed of sale, there was nothing mentioned as to the price? Not even the word price was mentioned in the deed of sale. Would that sale be void? Of course, not necessarily. In fact, who would have the burden of proving that it is void? The party who is claiming that the contract is void, because the law provides that even if the cause is not stated in the contract, it is presumed to exist. Okay? There is a presumption of the law that it exists. Not only that, the law presumes the cause to be lawful. Whoever would claim that there was no such cause or it is unlawful would have the burden of proving such. Okay? Now, on its face, parang the presumption is illogical. Di ba dapat in a deed of sale, kung walang price, dapat ang presumption, walang cause. Kasi walang price eh. But the law says, no, even if it is not stated, it is presumed that there was a cause. Do I agree with this presumption nonetheless? Yes. Because if a person enters into a contract, there must have been a reason. Di ba? If he was the seller, because he must have been promised a price to be paid. Okay? Kaya siya pumasok sa kontrata. In other words, why there was no price stated in the contract could be that there was a verbal agreement, hindi lang inilagay sa kontrata. Okay? Or there could be a side agreement, wala lang sa deed of sale. Why would the parties not state in the contract yung price? May mga reason. Okay? In an actual contract I prepared for a corporation, the reason was that this corporation had several such properties, similar, maraming ganong properties, and they would want to dispose these properties. So they, as to the first buyer, they don't want to be bound to the price in relation to the other items. Okay? So kung nag-agree sila dito na 2.5 million, they still would want to sell the other items at higher price. Di ba? Kaya ayaw nilang ilagay doon para hindi makasabi ang prospective buyer, eh, binenta mo na ng ganitong price before eh. Di ba? That could be a good reason why the price may not be stated. Okay? Now, of course, this presumption clearly is only a disputable presumption. Now, the law also requires, obviously, that it must exist. There has to be a cause. Okay? Kung walang cause, there is no valid contract. Take note, it is a common error to claim that in gratuitous contracts, there is no cause. Mali yan, okay? In gratuitous contracts, the cause is the liberality. Okay? Otherwise, kung ganun pala, that in gratuitous contracts, there is no cause, there would be no valid gratuitous contract. Because if a contract has no cause, or the cause is unlawful, the law provides it is void. It will never have any effect at all. Okay? It can never have any effect. Now, but another requirement is the cause must be real, must be true. Because under the law, if the cause is a false cause, the contract is void. But take note, this statement is no longer absolutely true, unlike the old civil code. Na pag false ang cause in the deed of sale, for example, or in a contract, the contract is void. Under the present provision sa Civil Code of the Philippines, even if the cause is false, the contract may still be a valid contract if it can be proven that there is another cause for the contract which is real and lawful. Okay? A good case here pertains to a contract of guarantee entered into by spouses. Okay? And when the principal, ang principal debtor was a partnership, when the partnership failed to pay, when the partnership defaulted, the creditor went after the guarantor, the spouses. Now, the spouses claimed that the contract of guarantee was void because the reason, the cause why they entered into that contract allegedly was their belief that they were partners in that partnership. And it turned out they were not partners and they were able to prove such fact to the court. Hindi pala sila partners. So, claiming that there was a false cause for the contract, then the contract is void. Okay? However, the creditor was able to prove that even if the spouses as guarantors were not partners in the partnership, they actually were creditors of the partnership. And therefore, was there a cause? The Supreme Court said yes. It is in the interest of the spouses that the partnership should have financial viability, di ba? In order for the partnership to be able to pay its debt to the spouses. Kaya there was a cost. Though it was the cost stated in the contract is a false cost, but there was another cost which was the real and lawful cost, and therefore the contract of guarantee was declared to be a valid and binding contract. Okay? A contract of sale involving a car. The price stated in the sale, deed of sale, was 1 peso. Valid sale? May it be a valid sale? The answer is definitely yes. Okay? Because under the law, lesion or inadequacy, even gross inadequacy of the price, this is easily reflected in sale. Okay? If the price is grossly inadequate, okay, ang value niya could be 350,000. Pero ang price stated in the deed of sale, 1 peso, the sale may still be a valid sale. Okay? Lesion as a rule does not affect the validity of the contract. Okay? Totoo yan because I actually entered into this contract already. Okay? A deed of sale was executed with me as the buyer involving a car. Again, the price was only 1 peso. Okay? Sana maulit muli, di ba? Ang sarap talagang bumili ng kotse na piso lang ang babayaran mo. Okay? But normally, why the deed of sale would reflect only 1 peso is because there is actually normally another cost aside from the 1 peso. Okay? Ang cost dito ay yung service which I rendered to the company like for 3 years already. So because I rendered service to the company for 3 years, they sold to me this car for only 1 peso. Okay? Sa ibang companies, they would require the employee or the officer to pay like 20% of the value, di ba? Mga ganong arrangements. Pero sa akin, 1 peso. Okay? In fact, if you have read this already sa mga news items, all of you must be familiar with Trinoma. Okay? Kung hindi pa kayo nakapunta, puntahan nyo. Okay? Maganda ang Trinoma. And the Trinoma is a joint venture project of 7 corporations, okay? Including Phil Estate, Ramcar, Unilab, 3 others, okay? So, and they leased that portion of the property from the government. Government property yan. Magkano ang rental annually? 1 peso. Di ba? Ang bait ng gobyerno. Okay? 1 peso lang ang rental nila. But, kasi ang reason talaga niyan, because itong companies na ito, sila ang party, isa sa mga parties, doon sa build, lease, and transfer agreement with the government in relation to line 3, yung EDSA line, okay? Now tawag nating MRT, okay? Sila talaga ang nag-build and they leased dati. Ngayon binili na yata ng government. Government na may control, okay? But when they leased, they were only assured as rental 15% ROI, return on investment. Kumbaga palabok na lang ito, itong lease over that area covered by Trinoma, that they can lease the property for so long a time, 25 or 50 years, for 1 peso annually. Okay? So again, gross inadequacy of the price, as a rule, does not affect, but take note, as the Supreme Court would warn us, if the price is grossly inadequate, okay, that may actually be the effect of vitiation of consent. Okay? Thus, courts should be vigilant always, sabi ng Supreme Court, of the possibility of vitiation of consent. That is why one of the contracting parties agreed, even if the even if there was lesion or gross inadequacy of the price. Kaya kung ang sale involving a parcel of land worth 1 million, ang price 10,000 lang, maybe because there was violence employed, maybe because there was fraud. Okay? Kaya, take note, the contract would be voidable not because of the lesion per se, but because of the vitiation of consent. In other words, the party claiming vitiation of consent would have to prove that there was such vice of consent. It would not suffice that they claimed that the price was grossly inadequate. Or a party to that contract may even be able to show the court that the contract is void because they really intended another transaction, kaya grossly inadequate ang price, which we have already discussed. This sale or contract may be a simulated contract. Ang tunay talaga nilang transaction ay donation, pero ang kanilang pinirma na kontrata ay deed of sale. Okay? So, the gross inadequacy of the price may actually be the effect of the fact that they intended another contract. Okay? So, that deed of sale, that contract of sale would be a void sale as it is merely a simulated sale, and the price would be considered as a simulated price. Okay? Now, but lesion per se may actually result in a defective contract. And the most popular of these contracts would be those contracts entered into by a guardian or entered into by the representative of absentees. Because when the ward or the absentee suffered lesion, which is more than 25 or more than 1/4 of the value, 25% or 1/4 of the value of the property, then the law provides that the contract is rescissible. Okay? Of course, we will discuss this contract. Okay? This contract in a while. Okay? Listen. So, we can proceed muna sa form. I think we can finish forms muna before we have a break. Okay? Forms. Okay? Verbal sale. Valid sale? Yes, it may be a valid and binding sale. Lease, verbal? Yes. Okay? Because under 1356, the law provides that contracts shall be obligatory in whatever form it may have been entered into. Okay? Provided all the essential requisites are present. That is the general rule. Okay? I would say the general rule because the law further provides, unless the law requires a particular form for the validity of the contract, or unless the law requires a particular form for the enforceability of the contract. However, the law may also provide a particular form as to how the contract may be proved. This time, as to this last scenario, the Supreme Court would say, this requirement as to form is only necessary for the greater efficacy or the convenience of the parties. Okay, I can start with the last one, where the form is necessary as to how the contract may be proved. The contracts enumerated pertaining to this requirement are the contracts or transactions covered under 1358. Okay? Under 1358, the law provides the following acts or contracts must be in a public instrument. Diba? Naka-enumerate dyan, which would include contracts involving the creation, transmission, modification, or extinguishment of real rights over immovables must be in a public instrument. Okay? In other words, sale sale of a parcel of land would result in the transmission of rights involving an immovable property. Therefore, is the form required for the validity of the contract? Of course not. Okay? the Supreme Court consistently would rule that 1358, under 1358, the form prescribed by law is neither necessary for the validity nor is it necessary for the enforceability. It is only necessary for the greater efficacy of the contract. In other words, in order for the contract to bind third persons, that contract, as a rule, must be in that form, public instrument. Why? As to parcels of land specifically, may a deed of sale, which would result in the transmission of rights, be registered if it is not in a public instrument? The answer is no. The register of deeds has no business accepting an instrument which is merely a private instrument for registration. So it is necessary in order for the contract to be registered, in other words, for the contract to be proven at least with the register of deeds for its registration and thereafter bind third persons. Okay? Now, in fact, the law specifically provides even that sale of immovables would be covered by 1403, which means statute of frauds, which means that that form may only be, in fact, again, under the statute of frauds, the only requirement for the enforceability is that the contract be in writing, not even that it be in a public instrument. Another provision, another contract which is mentioned in 1358, which is apparently required to be in a public instrument, is the power to administer property, okay? or any other power which has for its object an act of appearing or which should appear in a public instrument. And that would include, for example, an administration of a parcel of land. But clearly, again, this is only necessary to bind third persons. As to the contracting parties, in relation to the administration of the property, a power of attorney need not be in a public instrument. Okay? It may simply be a private instrument. Now, so going into the contracts, okay, where the law requires a particular form for the validity of the contract, okay? Let's start with a contract of sale. Is there a provision under the Civil Code of the Philippines requiring a particular form as to the contract of sale in order for the sale to be valid? Okay? A common answer is yes, sale of immovables or sale of parcels of land. Which is wrong, okay? The Civil Code did not require such sale to be in writing for the validity. It only requires such sale for the enforceability of the contract. In other words, a sale of a parcel of land or a sale of an immovable property which is not in writing is not void. It is merely unenforceable under the statute of frauds. Okay? However, there is a special law, obviously not under the Civil Code, which requires a particular sale to be in a public instrument for the sale to be valid. And this is the cattle registration decree in relation to sale of large cattle. Okay? When I asked one of my students, can you give me an example of a large cattle? Ang sagot niya, large dog. Diba? Ang ganda talaga ng sagot. Lahat ng estudyante tumatawa. Okay? Large dog. Now, baka nga. They can be classified as large cattle. Okay? Now, in fact, more than just the requirement that the sale must be in a public instrument, the law further provides that the sale must be registered and the certificate of title must be obtained by the buyer for such sale to be valid. Okay? Some, if not most students, actually have not seen a certificate of title of large cattle. Di ba? Ang mga kalabaw may certificate of title din. Parang lupa siya. Okay? Kasi nung unang panahon, ganun sila kaimportante sa bansang ito. Okay? To the point that lahat ng tao halos may kalabaw. Okay? Yung iba, mayroon, pero dahil tenant sila. Diba? Ang may-ari talaga, yung may-ari ng lupa. Okay? Kaya may certificate of title ang mga large cattles. In fact, this I would tell my students na ito ang certificate sa parcels of land, may drawing ba ng lupa? Wala, di ba? Yung certificate of title, kung ano ang forma niya. Pero sa large cattle, may picture. Okay? May picture ang kalabaw. Okay? Pero hindi naman colored ang picture. Ano lang, two-dimensional nga lang eh. Okay? Side view, dalawang side view. Hindi naman back view. Hindi masyado maganda ang back view ng kalabaw. Okay? So, dalawang side view. Bakit kailangan ng picture ng side view ng mga kalabaw? This is the way of identifying the carabao. Dahil sa mga puyo ng kalabaw. Okay? A carabao would have so many of this. Okay? Kung saan-saan located. So, kung saan nakalagay, yun ang mag-identify that this is the carabao of Juan. Okay? Di ba ang tao din may puyo? And ordinarily, ang tao isa lang. Okay? Pero pag dalawa, tatlo ang puyo, may pagka-animal ang dating. Di ba? Kaya ang tawag natin sa kanila, pasaway. Kaya pasaway ang batang ito. Naku, kasi tatlo ang puyo. Okay? Ganon ang mga animal. Maraming puyo. Okay? Carabaos, mga cows. Okay? Marami. Okay? Now, aside from sale, okay? Of course, a common example ng mga authors of a transaction, not really a contract, required to be in a particular form is a donation. Okay? Donation of an immovable should be in a public instrument. Okay? Donation of a movable property, take note, where the value exceeds 5,000 pesos should be in a private instrument. And the acceptance should likewise be in such instrument. Now, however, if the donation pertains only to a movable property where the value does not exceed 5,000, the law does not require a particular form as to the donation. Rather, the law requires that there should be simultaneous delivery of the thing donated, okay? In order for the donation to be valid. Now, under the law on partnership, what the law requires as to form is not the form of the partnership contract itself. When an immovable property is contributed, the law requires that there should be an inventory of such immovable property. Okay? Take note again, the requirement does not pertain to the form of the partnership contract itself. But it requires a form because an inventory is always in writing. In fact, it should be signed by all contracting parties in order for the partnership to be valid. Okay? As to the other formalities in partnership, I will discuss that sa law on partnership. Now, in agency, being a preparatory contract, if the authority of the agent is not in writing, it may have an effect on the validity of the agency? The answer is no. Even if the authority of the agent is only a verbal authorization, that will not result in a void agency, but it may result in a void contract entered into by the agent. Specifically, this would happen under 1874 if the agent was authorized to sell a parcel of land and his authority is not in writing, it is the sale which is void. Hindi agency ang void ay ang sale. Okay? Even if the sale itself is in writing, it doesn't matter. It is void because the authority of the agent is not in writing. I mentioned already anticresis, which is really a formal contract because the law requires a particular form for as far as the principal and the interest is concerned. The law requires that it should be in writing. Okay? Otherwise, the anticresis is void. Now, aside from these contracts, there are certain stipulations. Okay, hindi na buong kontrata, but only stipulations which are required to be in writing. Otherwise, the stipulation would not be a valid stipulation. Concretely, in loans, okay, simple loans, I may have mentioned last night that in order for the creditor to be entitled to interest, which is compensatory interest, meaning the interest here is compensation for the use of the money, which means this is the interest from the time the money was borrowed to the time the obligation to pay becomes due and demandable. Yun ang compensatory. Because from the time the obligation became due and there was demand and there was failure to pay, he would already be liable for interest by way of damages. Okay? So dito, hindi na kailangan ng stipulation. Okay? Even if there is no stipulation or agreement as to interest, there can be liability for interest because he is already in delay. But not from the time he borrowed money, from the time he was in delay. Dito sa compensatory interest, the law expressly requires that there must be an express stipulation in writing in order for the creditor to be entitled to interest. Okay? Also, in lease of service involving common carriers, contracts of carriage, okay? A stipulation providing for a lesser degree of diligence as to the diligence that should be observed by the common carrier and the transportation of goods, for example, it may be a valid stipulation only again, okay, if it is put into writing and signed by the shipper. Okay, otherwise, that stipulation would be void. The last question here would be, how would you know when a law requires a form, how would you know if the law requires a form for its validity? Or maybe that law requires only the form for enforceability, or maybe only for the greater efficacy. Thus, if the law requires a form and the parties fail to comply with the form prescribed by law, does it mean that the contract is automatically void? The answer is not necessarily. Okay, a good example here is a contract of partnership where the contracting parties contributed property or money which is 3,000 or more. Okay, the law requires that such contract shall be in writing and must be registered with the SEC. If you just consider the rule on statutory construction, ordinarily when the law uses the word shall and must, they are necessary, diba? Mandatory yan. If not, apparently the contract would be void, but not so. Okay, a contract of partnership may be valid even if the partnership agreement was not put into writing, despite the fact that they promised to contribute money which is more than 3,000 pesos. Okay, I will discuss the reasons when we discuss the law on partnership. But for now, ang last question na lang ay, how would you know, therefore, when would a contract be void if there is failure to comply with a formality prescribed by law, and when would it not be void? The Supreme Court ruled, for example, in the case of Dauden Hernaez versus the Los Angeles. Dauden Hernaez is Carol Dauden. Those na medyo kaedad ko ng konti would know her to be a star, at least a starlet, okay? Para may pagka bold star nung panahon nung 70s, even I think early 80s, Carol Dauden. This case pertains to a movie project which is not in writing, okay? Now, the Supreme Court ruled, if the law requires a form and the form was not complied with, the contract will only be void if the law so provides for the nullity of the contract. In other words, even if the law requires a form, but the law does not provide for the nullity of the contract in case of non-compliance, then that is not necessary for the validity. In other words, that form may only be necessary for the enforceability, or that form may only be necessary for the greater efficacy of the contract. Okay? Kaya, pagdating sa anti-crisis, anong nakalagay? when the law says that the agreement as to the principal and interest must be in writing, the law further states, otherwise the antecedens is void. In donation, if there is a donation of an immovable property, the law requires that the donation must be in a public instrument. Nakalagay in the next sentence, otherwise the donation is void. So the law itself would provide for the nullity of the contract in case that formality is necessary for the validity of the contract. Okay? So, into the last, the law may require a form for the enforceability of the contract. Ito medyo mas madali because practically there are only two groups of contracts where the law requires a particular form in order for the contract to be enforceable. The first group of contracts are those contracts covered by the statute of frauds, okay? Which we will discuss sa unenforceable contracts, okay? The other set of contracts which may be unenforceable because of the failure to comply with a formality prescribed by law are those contracts covered by 1878 under the law on agency. Under this article, for certain acts and contracts, the agent must have a special power of attorney. If he doesn't have a special power of attorney, as a rule, the contract entered into by the agent with a third person will be unenforceable as against the principal. Okay? But also, we will discuss this article exhaustively when we discuss the law on agency. Kaya, tapos na tayo sa formalities ng contracts, at least in general. So, let's have a break, okay? Before we discuss reformation.